السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This corner here is still very excited. السلام عليكم guys. Can I get your attention? I know I'm not very exciting person, but anyway, we'll try my best to be cool. Let's do it again. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Once again, brothers and sisters, boys and girls, I'd like to thank all of you for making your time, making yourself available to come here to this program. I know it's very hot, very small place. We are toasting here, but it's all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I believe that everyone comes here with the right intention. And if you got the right intention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fix any shortcoming in the action and give you the full reward, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all of us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success in this life and the life to come. Allahumma ameen. I'm intending to make it very, very short because I have an injury here. Does anyone know what happened? Can anybody guess? I told you before. Huh? What that? No, I was just trying to argue with my wife. So, not the first time anyway. Okay. I received a question today and I have to answer it. This question is about Uber Eats, halal or haram? A lot of people, you know, they're hand in heart. If the sheikh says haram, I'm in trouble. Who's doing Uber Eats here? Well, our deen is very well established and very clear. It is based on qawa'id. Qawa'id means principles. It's not open for anyone to say anything. It's very well organized and very well integrated. And for us Muslims, we know for sure that every single Muslim, I mean, we know we should go between halal and haram. We should watch out what is halal and what is haram. That's our mission in life. And we know also for sure, if you leave something haram for the sake of Allah, Allah will replace it with something halal, much, much better than what you have left for the sake of Allah. If you have any doubt about it, don't listen to the answer, right? Once you leave something haram or doubtful for the sake of Allah, keep in mind that Allah will replace it with something much, much better than what you ever imagined. And I can't forget this story of somebody named Abdul Karim Germanos. He's a German guy who converted to Islam years ago. And when he accepted Islam, he changed his life. He stopped drinking alcohol. He stopped eating pork. He got married to his partner. And he stopped going to the nightclubs. He behaves like a human being. He doesn't behave like an animal. So he was a very decent person. He lost his job because he was doing such a kind of job that doesn't suit his faith as a Muslim. So he left his job. His wife got mad on him. How are we going to pay the bills? How are we going to feed the children? How are we going to pay the mortgage? And blah, 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 blah. Right? He followed the job ads around, you know, the area. And he found a job very suitable to him, very, very suitable to his expertise and his also education. He went for the interview and he was the last one. And then the interviewer asked him, do you drink alcohol? He said, no. Do you eat pork? He said, no. He said, are you married? He said, yes. And goodbye. He said, why? Well, why are you leaving? He said, because your question means that I'm not qualified for the job. Because, you know, I'm not the one you are looking for. He said, actually, all the people before you answered yes. And we're looking for somebody who doesn't do any of those things. Who doesn't drink, who doesn't eat pork. Somebody who is married in a stable relationship. We want somebody like that. And all the people came before you, they are not qualified. You are the only one qualified for the job. He said, Subhanallah. I thought that I lost my life and my job because of my Islam. Now I am the only one qualified for this job because I am a Muslim. Subhanallah. So our the principles of our deen are very clear. One of the many, one of the main principles is وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى إِثْمُ الْعُدْوَانِ. Help each other to do the right things and do not help anyone who is doing something sinful. Anyone who does something sinful, don't help or assist him. Otherwise, you will take the, otherwise you will take the same punishment, the same sin. You are sharing the same sin, the same guilt. So, in the ideal world, not here, you're supposed to decline any job that is offered to you, and you're supposed to know what is inside the parcel, and you're supposed to choose to serve whom you want to serve, and to not to serve whom you don't want to serve. But in this world, in this DNA, in this context, you don't know what is inside the parcel, you don't know who is your customer, you just pick up the parcel of food from a restaurant that you don't know and deliver it to a customer that you don't know. If this parcel contains alcohol, or contains pork, or contains maita, maita is a dead animal that is not halal, then you are actually taking part in the same sin. So you are actually equal in the sin with the same guy who consumed that. But what can I do? This is a non-Muslim country. Fine. Not everyone who lives in the non-Muslim country has to do something haram to survive. You will find another option, even if you have to go and work on the roadworks. Because in the end, you are not ready to compromise your deen for the sake of a few dollars. Because in the end, if I say haram, halal to you to make you happy, and you know, make you feel good about yourself, you can't take my word for granted, because other people say it is haram. Why? Because you are helping people to, you know, consume something non-halal or to drink alcohol. And Rasulullah said, anyone who take part in alcoholism, serving alcohol or consuming alcohol, he is cursed. Not just sinful, he is cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mal'oon. What is mal'oon? He is kicked out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't have any share in Allah's mercy. Right? It's very tough, I know. And it's not realistic to, you know, give up your work easy like that. But it is what it is. If you have accepted Islam, then you have accepted the terms and conditions of this contract with Allah. What is this contract with Allah? سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We listen and obey. No question asked. Don't do like, you know, when Rasulullah ﷺ said to the people something, and they start like feeling hesitant. Oh, I don't think it's the right decision. He said, هَلَكَ النَّاسِ. People are gone, destroyed. They ruined themselves. Why? They are now doing like Bani Israel, the children of Israel. They argue with their prophet. How dare you argue with your prophet if he say halal or haram, yes or no? So when he went back again to them, he found all of them listening to him and doing whatever he wanted them to do. He said, Alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless my companions, my ashab, because now I believe that they have really good heart, subhanallah. For some time, for a few minutes, they were hesitant, but again, they decided to obey Rasulullah ﷺ unconditionally. This is a contract with Allah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Yes, in some cases it can be halal. Yes, if you know what is inside the food parcel and you know the customer is not consuming something haram, then you are absolutely fine to deliver this parcel. But if you know or you have doubt that what is inside is not halal, then there is a big question mark. You better leave it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will replace it inshallah with something halal. And Allah will feed you from halal. And if Allah feed you from halal, then your body is built for the Jannah. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala feed you from halal, then this is an indication, a promise from Allah that Allah is preparing you for the Jannah. But if Allah allow you to feed in haram, or you allow yourself to feed from haram, it does mean that there is an indication that your body is prepared for Jahannam, wal'iyazu billah. Some stains in the clothes can be washed with water, and some stains in the clothes can be washed with the washing powder, and some other stains cannot be washed at all, and you have to chuck the clothes in the rubbish because you can't clean it. Rasulullah ﷺ said, the dirty body, flesh and blood that is contaminated with haram food, haram nutrition, there is no way to clean it
before going to the Jannah unless this body, this person is burned in the hellfire for some time. Mm. This is the only way to clean him. Subhanallah. And I don't think anyone is ready for this kind of, you know, cleanliness. We are happy to go to Jannah, alhamdulillah. We are hoping to go to the Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the Jannah. One more thing I would like to share with you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is very well known hadith, but I just want to, you know, explain it in a different way. We already know this hadith, but it's not, it has something to do with everyone's life, not very limited to this situation. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَخْتَلَى رَجُلٌ بِمْرَأَةٍ إِلَّا كَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ ثَلِثَهُمَا. You've heard that before. When a man and woman get together alone, from the away from the eyes of the people, the third one will be the shaitan, right? The third one will be shaitan, right? What we think, oh, this is a strange man, you know, alone with a strange woman, then shaitan is there to make them, like, you know, make something haram, correct? Is it what we understand? Yes. But in reality, Rasulullah ﷺ didn't say a stranger with a stranger. He said, any man with any woman get together, shaitan is the third one. And this applies to a husband and wife. So when you and your wife alone, the people are not around, the children of your are not around, watch out. There is somebody sitting in the room between you and your wife. Who is this guy? It is shaitan. He is creating problem between you and your wife. And that is why, because we don't think about it that way, we think it's all about a stranger. You know, a strange man and strange woman, they do something haram together because shaitan is the third one. But in reality, any woman and any man and woman get together alone from the eyes of the people, they will be affected by shaitan. And you can call it when, you know, when a husband and wife together and the children and around, they may behave themselves. But when they are alone in their bedroom or, you know, nobody around, you know, they kind of, you know, behave normal. They open up and problems start, subhanallah. So don't feel secure and safe when you are and your wife alone, because there is a third party in the conversation trying to create problems. And in most of the cases, shaitan is so easily able to create this problem. We know from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that shaitan every night, he set up his kursi, his big seat as a king on the surface of water. And he sit down and receive the reports from his workers. He send out workers to work, spread corruption in the earth. Everyone should come with achievement. This is a task I was given, I have done it. So he received a payment. So everyone has a job. Every little shaitan, you know, has a job. So they come and everyone present his report. So one shaitan stand up, a devil stand up and I said, "Huh, boss, you know, today I tried my best with this guy and eventually he drink alcohol." Okay, well done. Sit down. Give him a chocolate. And then another shaitan stand up and say, "I tried my best with this guy until he fornicated, he committed zina." Okay, well done. Give him 2 chocolates. And then another one will stand up and say, "Today I tried my best with a husband and wife, and they end up divorcing." He stand up like that. "Come on, guy," and give him a big hug. And, you are the man, you are the man. Forget about those kids. You are the real man, subhanallah. This is the real achievement, subhanallah. How is it possible he managed to create that, I mean, to make, cause divorce between husband and wife? Because he is always chasing them when they are together. So if you and your wife alone, then make sure that you close your doors from the shaitan. How I close my door? One magic or one miraculous tool. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَكُلِّ عِبَادِي يَقُولُ الَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Choose the best word you can say. Because the best word, not the nice word, but the best of all words you have to say. Because any word that you say during this conversation will be completely misunderstood. If you say right, it will be wrong. If you say left, it will be wrong. If you say in the middle, it will be also wrong. I don't know what you should say, but you find a word that doesn't look like it's a wrong word. So try your best to say the best of words. Why? Because shaitan is waiting for anything to come out of your mouth to create a problem. Similarly, he is waiting for any problem, any word to come from her mouth to create a problem. And this problem becomes so big, sometimes it ends up in divorce just because of a very little issue. Very, very little issue. Why? Because Shaitan is very well trained and who was doing this job for thousands of years. Thousands of years, subhanAllah. You see? So this is something also to take apart, to take away, and make sure that you have to be careful when you and your wife, but don't go and tell her, "A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim," when you say your wife. Why? Because Shaitan is here. What do you mean? I'm a Shaitan? Oh, and then the battle starts. You will lose. So say it in yourself. Say it inside. Okay, I have four words I have to, we have to understand. Every single Muslim, I was talking about the heart. I have four words you have to understand very clearly to understand this topic of the heart. We have the word ruh. Ruh, you know this word? Ruh. We have the word qalb, we have the word aql, we have the word nafs. Okay, can you say them again? Huh? Ruh, qalb, aql, nafs. These words are there in the Quran. And every word has a topic or has, you know, has some attention, receive an attention from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we mix them together, we put ourselves in trouble. Why? Because when we read the Quran, even with the translation, the translator make mistakes in these words, so you misunderstand the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you have the word ruh, and you have the word qalb, and aql, and nafs. Rough translation in English, you know, ruh, soul, S-O-U-L, and qalb, heart, right? And aql means mind or intellect, nafs means self. Inner self. Okay? What do they mean in the Quran, and what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to say about four of them? The word ruh is the secret of life. Nobody knows about it except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is not an area of investigation. We cannot explore it. It is the divine element inside ourselves, inside this body. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this body from dirt, from soil. And he put inside this body a ruh. This ruh is unknown to anyone, including the messengers and the prophet. Nobody knows about it except Allah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received three questions and he answered two and he couldn't answer the third one. He asked Allah those three questions and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered two. And the third question he said to him, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنُ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرَ رَبِّي. They asked him about the young people in the cave. He told them the story. They asked him about Dhul Qarnayn, and he answered the story. He answered them, give them the answer. This is in Surah Al-Kahf. In Surah Al-Isra, the surah before it, he answered the third question saying, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنُ الرُّوحِ. They ask you about الروح. Tell them, say to them, كُلُ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّ. It is something belong to Allah. وَمَا أُتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. You have very little knowledge about it. And you can't find out about it. Since the beginning of the creation until today, scholars and scientists and, you know, philosophers, they are trying their best to find out what this ruh is, but they all failed. Nobody knows what it is except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what we know from the Quran, this is the divine element that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inserted inside Adam alayhi salam. And he made him a human being. He was just a statue. He was made, created from dirt, from, you know, and this dirt became tin, mud, and then after that dried up, it becomes a clay, and it was burned down, becomes like, you know, salsal. And then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed a ruh inside it, and it becomes a human being. Once this ruh departs from the body, then this body becomes back again dirt and soil. Simple as that. The only time we're going to see the ruh is when it leaves the body. This is the only time me and you will see the ruh. And that is why Rasulullah ﷺ said, if somebody is about to die, he will open his eyes and look up, following a ruh, leaving his body and going out. And once the ruh leaves the body, he doesn't have power to close his eyes again. So you people supposed to close his eyes, right? And he says, when you see somebody dying and the ruh is leaving the body, you make very good dua for him and for yourself. That's why, don't ever make any bad dua or make a yell or scream or say something or, you know, clap on your face or something like that. Because the angels are there and they say Ameen on all of your dua. If you say, Ya Allah, and the wife is, you know, the husband is dying, and you say, Ya Allah, don't leave me here in this world and after him. Okay, accepted. You know, processed. Subhanallah. See? So, he said, فَلَا تَدْعُوا عَلَى أَنفُسِكُمْ بِشَرْ Rasulullah ﷺ said, do not make dua against yourselves, otherwise you will be in trouble. So this is a ruh, we know nothing about it. Some of the scientists actually, Jazakallah khair, they made some sort of experiment. We're not 100% sure of the result, but they bought somebody dying, put him on the scale, and they weighed him. After he passed away, the ruh departed, he was about 100 grams less. So what are those 100 grams? They said, this is the ruh that departed. It could be sweating, it could be something, but Allah knows better. But it has a volume, and it has a shape, and it has a life. And this ruh never die. The body die, but the ruh will never die. This ruh leave our body every single night. When we go to sleep, the ruh leave the body. Rasulullah ﷺ said, when the people go to sleep, the arwah, the plural of the word ruh, they leave the body and go and make sujood under Allah's arsh. They travel through the spaces and they reach the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all of them, you know, make sujood. And they meet each other. He said, الأرواح جنود مجندة ما تعارف منها أتلف وما تناكر منها اختلف. They are able to recognize each other in their world. So in the world of this reality, in the reality world, you may come across somebody that you never seen him to before, and you say, man, I thought I've seen you before. And I'm not from this country. How come did you see me? I don't know. I just remember. One day I have seen you. Yes, you have seen him. But what happened? You've seen his ruh when you and him were just there under the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also sometimes you find yourself in a situation, you think this happened before. And you look at yourself, man, I think I've been in this place before. And I was sitting in the same place, listening to the same talk. Have you experienced something like that? Something happened to you. It happened, but you never know, or you don't remember where did it happen. Because when the arwah, the souls, get together under Allah's arsh, they actually read the script of their life. They come to know what is happening next. But before they go back to your body, the memory is deleted. They know nothing. But some traces of these actions or these future actions is already restored in your memory. So when they take place, you think this happened before, but you don't know when this happened. When this happened. These arwah or souls never die, and they have one of two places. Once they depart from the body, they have one or two places. One place is Illiyin, and the other place is Sijjin. Illiyin, it's very high in the Jannah. When somebody passes away, the ruh leaves and travels through the space, through the heaven, until it settles in the Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes this ruh and put it in the Jannah, that it enjoys everything. But this ruh, brothers and elders, doesn't actually calculate time. Because it is created outside the limits of time and space. So this ruh will live in the Jannah, if it's a good ruh, for many, many years, maybe for thousands of years. But once this ruh goes back again to the body, it will remember no time. And that is why when we get up on the day of Qiyam and Allah will ask us, how long you've been in the grave, the answer will be the same. Yawman aw ba'da yawm. Maybe some day, half a day or few hours, but it was thousands of years, because the ruh doesn't calculate time, because it is created outside the boundaries of time and space. They can travel through the space at the speed Allah knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. They can easily reach from earth to the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in no time. Why I say in no time? Because people can sleep in no time. Sometimes you talk to yourself or talk to somebody and all of a sudden he's outside this world, sleep, snoring. What happened? His ruh already traveled. Very quickly like that. Where is his ruh now? Up there, subhanAllah. And when you wake him up, he wakes up like, huh? Yes, yes, what's going on? His ruh is back. See how quick it is? It traveled to the arsh and it is back right now. And all what we see when we are sleeping, this is actually what is happening with the ruh. This is a scenario that this is, you know, the outside the boundaries of this world. You see things unimaginable because this is the world of our arwah, the world of the souls. We know nothing about it except what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, very, very little things. This is ar-ruh. Al-qalb. Al-qalb has two things. La ilaha illallah. I'm out of my time. Just 5 more minutes, I'm done. Because I'm on the ACC, right? I'm injured. Al-qalb. Al-qalb physically is the heart, but this heart that we do have here, right, inside our chest, has also two sides. One side is the spiritual side, which is also unknown to any one of us, and the other side is the physical side. This physical heart, which pumps the blood, can be treated by surgery, by heart specialists, but inside this heart, some chemical actions that are known or unknown to anyone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what these chemical actions happen. What are these chemical actions? What they do and what they are, how they control the body? But what we know from Islam or from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this heart or this chemical reactions create the decision that we make. So they influence our decision. This heart influence our decisions, whether to choose to do right thing or the bad thing, subhanAllah. And that is why in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about the people who accept guidance, that their heart is open because they make the right decision. And when he talk about the bad guys, the disbelievers or the sinful, he said their heart are sealed. And we spoke about that last time, because this decision-making device inside their heart is not functioning properly. That is why they make the wrong decision. Just to your and for your information, recently, I think this month or last month, the first successful transplantation of a non-human heart inside the human body took place in Britain. And it was conducted by a Muslim surgeon, heart specialist. They take the heart of a pig, khinzir, and they transplanted in a human being, and it is successfully working. So somebody got a khinzir inside him, and then they come and say, is it halal or haram? You made life complicated, guys. Anyway, we're not going to eat you anyway, to say. But the thing is, you have the heart of a khinzir. What kind of decision you think you're going to make? La ilaha illallah. Subhanallah. You know, by the way, one of the features of the khinzir, of the pig, that they are not able to raise the head up, so they never look at the sky, they always look at the earth, and they have no jealousy whatsoever, no jealousy. So the male pig goes out and invite all the males in the group to share his partner or his wife. He doesn't mind to have all of them sharing his wife. He doesn't care about that. And the people who eat a particular type of meat for a long time, they get the same feature of this animal. So this jealousy, no jealousy, transfer to the people who eat pork. So they end up have no jealousy. They don't mind. You know, the girl comes back home so excited. Dad, I got a boyfriend. Oh, well done. I'm pregnant. Oh, congratulations. You know, is there any marriage? I don't care. What happened? It's not my business. And if he found his daughter very upset and very, you know, unhappy. What is wrong with you, baby? Because I am 18 years old, I'm still virgin. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. La hawla wa la quwwata. This is how they look at their life. No jealousy at all, subhanAllah. You see? And people who eat camel meat, who is here eating camel meat? They become, mashallah, very submissive and very obedient, because the camel is a very submissive animal. And the people who eat a lot of cow meat or beef meat, they become very violent. It's also be careful, I'm going to eat beef. Subhanallah. So one of the tactics you can do, no beef at home, you and your wife will be in peace. But so as long as you eat beef, okay, get ready for the better. Sorry, brother. but the beef in the butcher shop, I know halal butcher shop is okay. We take it to, you know, the heart, you see? So the heart is the physical heart inside. This is the in charge of pumping the blood, we know that. But this heart has two things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told about them. This heart has a memory. All your actions, all your memory are stored in the heart, not in the brain. Okay? I'm quoting the Quran. Not quoting. I am not a scientist, I'm not a physical doctor. I'm just quoting what the Quran. All of my memory inside my heart, and the decision-making device, it is inside my heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, listen carefully, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَى الْأَبْصَارِ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَى الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. Allah doesn't even, he said, what does blindness mean? It is not the blindness of the eye, it is the blindness of the heart is inside the chest. He didn't just say the hearts, because somebody might say, you know, my heart is in this, you know. Anyway, he said, the heart is inside the chest. فَإِنَّهَا لَتَعْمَى الْأَبْصَارُ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَى الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. Blindness means that they are not able to make a good decision. They just go right and left, and they always make wrong decisions, subhanAllah. They don't know what is halal and haram. They just go after their desire. So this is the heart. This heart is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have very, very little control on this decision making. It's all in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah said, Al-Qulubu bayna isba'ayni min asabi' al-Rahman. Yuqallibuhuma kayfa yasha. He said, the hearts are between two fingers of Allah's hand. Again, don't imagine, no description. He turns them upside down the way he wants. And that is why the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam all the time, Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala dini. O the one who turned the hearts upside down, keep my heart steadfast on your deen. Because we have very limited control on this decision-making device inside our heart. Does it mean that I don't have a freedom of a choice? No. You don't have a freedom of a choice. But guess what? This freedom is not inside your heart. The freedom is inside your brain, your aql. Because your aql will open for you the introduction to the decision. Let me give you an example. You know, when there is a manager in the company, he got some people, advisors, who give him some advice to make a decision. Say, for example, he got a salesperson, he got a marketing person, you know, manager, they get together in a meeting and everyone presents his own, you know, idea or whatever. And then the manager's job is to what? Do what? Make a decision, right? The manager is not supposed to know everything in the market or about the work or the business, because he already employed people to work, and based on the information they provide for him, he make a decision. So our brain, our intellect, our mind, right? And our nafs, those two things, the nafs and the aql, they present the information to the heart and the heart make the decision. Based on the information you present, your heart will be making the decision. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let the heart make the decision. So what you need to know, or what you need to do as a human being, is to get the right information and use the right employee to get the right information. Use your aql and your nafs properly, your heart will make the right decision, your soul will be in peace. Sounds very complicated, right? I know it is very complicated. But I will actually spend more time to explain. But the first stage to know, the soul is the divine element, the heart is the device of the decision making inside the chest, and it has little, we have little control in this heart, and the heart makes the decision based on the information he receives from the self, from the nafs, and from the aql. And based on this information, the heart makes the decision, or Allah will allow it to make the decision, whether it is right and wrong. And Rasulullah said to the people when they said, what is the point? If Allah already subhanahu wa ta'ala controlled the heart, what is the point? He said, اعملوا فكلوا ميسر الله. Do your best, because Allah will make your heart take the decision that you think of. If your brain and your nafs is, you know, kind of inclined or interested to do something, you know, good, then Allah will make the heart decide to do the good. And if your aql, your brain, your mind, and your nafs, you know, inclined to do something bad, or even Allah will make the heart make the decision to do something bad. Right? This is how does it work, and how the body and the ruh, and how the aql and the ruh and the mind function together to come up with the decision. These decisions actually influence our life and influence our future. And because this influence our future, whether we go to Jannah or to the hellfire, we have to make sure that the link between the heart and the soul and the aql and nafs is in a very good way, very good form and shape. And inshallah, if Allah extend my life, I will explain to you how to make these four things work together so you find it easy to make the right decision. How it is easy? You will make it easy to get up for Fajr. You will have no trouble at all waking for Fajr. You will have no trouble to eat halal. You will have no trouble to do the right thing. But and at the same time, you will find it very difficult to do something haram. Because we don't actually train them, those four things, properly. We don't use them properly. We find ourselves easy going on to do something haram and hard to do something halal. We find the halal hard and we find the haram easy. Why? Because we are not able to manage those four things properly. I know it sounds academic, but it's actually very interesting to learn about those four things and how they function together. That will make, inshallah, you know, our way to the Jannah so easy. And that is one of the reasons why the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why Rasulullah worked very hard on teaching the people those four things. And the Sahaba were excellent, excellent people because of they manage those four things. If we don't manage them properly, we are in trouble. We find life really very complicated and deen also very complicated. But inshallah, I promise we will find it so easy inshallah once we learn properly about those four things. Now it's time to finish and stop. We make dua inshallah. I'm not sure if there is enough time for dinner or not. Still, I think 20 minutes you can eat, or you can eat after Isha. It's up to you. But anyway, we finish today inshallah. Right now, we make dua and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will get us to the right decision. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم اغفر وارحم وتجاوز عما تعلم إنك أنت العز الأكرم. ربنا آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.